Hi dear friends and subscribers, welcome to the Cricket Happening Show with your host Ram today. And in this part of the Cricket Happening Show, we are going to look at the third day's play between New Zealand and England, where we had Hamish Rutherford, the opening batsman, the son of former batsman Ken Rutherford, making 171 on his debut. What a wonderful debut it was. And New Zealand was sitting pretty at 420 for 7 at close of play on the third day's play, when actually rain stopped play and the players had to troop back off to the pavilion. I'll be talking about Hamish Rutherford in particular, what a debut he made, in sharp contrast to what debut his father and former batsman from New Zealand, Ken Rutherford, had made. I'll talk about that. And then we will also look at the test series starting between Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. After all the controversy that Sri Lankan players had of signing the contract, they signed the contract, and finally Angelo Matthews, the full-time test captain, got his team to actually bat first. And well, Sri Lanka were placed very well at that, but on the first day they finished at 361 for 3, the feature being Kumar Sangakarra on his comeback, opening the innings with Dimut Karnaratne and scoring a sparkling century. In fact, he had a century before tea. He had actually scored a century. So essentially, in two sessions, he had scored a century, and he was out for 142 in a Sri Lankan score which closed on the first day at 361 for 3. Well, so against Bangladesh. Well, so what I'm going to do is, since there are two matches to cover, I won't be actually be able to go into those details, but I will be covering the important features of the match. So first, let's look at the game at the University Oval in Dunedin, where it was the third day yesterday, New Zealand versus England. And New Zealand resumed at their over at 131 for no loss, and the partnership was pushed on to 158. This was a very good opening partnership, and that was the first wicket which went was Peter Fulton, as the breakthrough was provided by James Anderson, as he got him caught by Pryor behind the wickets for 55 with 8 boundaries. After that, it was all Hamish Rutherford. And Hamish Rutherford, I'm going to talk mostly this particular Cricket Happening Show, as far as this Cricket Happening Show is concerned, is going to be really centered on Hamish Rutherford, because Hamish Rutherford was the one, as I said, he's the son of former batsman Ken Rutherford. And Ken Rutherford, if one remembers his debut, he actually made his debut against the West Indies when West Indies were absolutely at its peak with Big Bird Joel Garner. They had Michael Holding, the Rolls-Royce bowler. They had Malcolm Marshall, the late Malcolm Marshall, who was there. It was quite pacey. And against the likes of that, Ken Rutherford was given a debut. And he had such a woeful debut that you could read a phone number. If you look at the series, if you go back to the series where Ken Rutherford actually played test match cricket, he made his debut, and he had a very woeful debut against the West Indies, where he was dismissed for 0-0. It was like a phone number, 0-0, 1-0-0. I do remember listening to the cricket commentary in those days, and Ken Rutherford was really, really struggling. And what was good about this New Zealand at that time was that the New Zealand selectors persisted with Ken Rutherford. Even though Ken Rutherford was an absolute failure in the series after making his debut, what was good to see was the New Zealand cricket actually persisted with Ken Rutherford, and Ken Rutherford came up trumps. After that, he was a regular in the New Zealand team. He came up with some century, and he was a very regular in the team. Now, in sharp contrast, Hamish Rutherford getting an opportunity because of Martin Guptill's injury. What a knock it was from Hamish Rutherford. He became the person to have the highest score on debut against England, with 171 to his name, with 22 fours and 3 sixes. And two of those sixes were hit off Monty Panesar after reaching 150. Just looking at Hamish Rutherford's innings, since he's a person who is newly inducted into the news in the test matches, Hamish Rutherford, I will say, well, he has lots of strokes. What was good to see, his driving was absolutely impeccable, and his cover driving was the stroke which had a stamp of class to it. And well, he was pretty strong on the offside, if the ball was actually short and wide, he used to really, really capitalize on that, especially if the ball used to be wide outside the off stump. Being a left-hander, he could actually carve it through the offside for boundaries with lots of poise. And Rutherford, what was good about him is a very aggressive bat. He doesn't believe in just staying at the crease. He likes to play strokes, and that's what he was precisely doing. You also saw him come down and loft Monty Panister for two sixes as he reached 150. What was the only thing that Rutherford probably needs to guard against is the short delivery. He was not pretty adept at actually handling the short delivery when he was bounced out by Anderson, Stephen Finn or Broad. But he still managed. But what was good about it is what whenever they were trying to bounce him out, it was good to see Ken Rutherford stay up, sway away from the line of the ball and leave it harmlessly to be taken by the wicketkeeper. So Hamish Rutherford, this innings, as I said, it was some flowing drives that we saw from Rutherford. And he was also, the short ball was not to his liking, but I'm sure Hamish Rutherford, you know, after making 171 in his on his debut, test debut, would definitely learn a lot. And going forward, I think Hamish Rutherford is a great investment for New Zealand cricket. What an opener! And if you see the New Zealand opening opening stand, you would have seen that there are a lot of players who played. Jamie Howe, who had that record double century in One Day International, which I talked about the other day, he was one player who was tried 19 tests, couldn't really perform. Tim McIntosh probably played 20 odd tests, he couldn't perform. Martin Guptill was out, but basically what was very, very a weak link for New Zealand was the opening partnership. The opening partnership is very vital in test matches to lay the foundation, and that was pretty, pretty lacking for New Zealand. So I think Hamish Rutherford is a great investment for New Zealand cricket, and he's going to go a long way for sure. 171 on test debut with 22 fours and three sixes, he would have definitely made his father Ken Rutherford proud about the achievement. And after that, well, Kane Williamson contributed 24 runs with three boundaries. He was a victim of Panesar, as Panesar actually clean bowled him. Ross Taylor contributed 31 with four boundaries, victim of Anderson. Anderson was the most successful bowler yesterday. And Dick Brownlee, after making 27, was clean bowled by Anderson with five boundaries. After that, Brendan McCullum played some attacking strokes to have an unbeaten 44 to his name, or 42 balls with 8 fours. Vijay Watling left a ball which was actually coming into him. He shouldered arms to it, and the bowler was Stuart Broad. And Brian Watling, of the very first delivery, saw the ball crashing onto his stumps after leaving the delivery. And Tim Southee, with some very, very good blows, actually reached 25 of 21 balls with 2 fours and 2 sixes. He was also a victim of Broad, as he was clean bowled for 25. And the end, as rain came, but what was interesting, Bruce Martin, who was actually making his debut, and he had a wonderful debut, getting 4 wickets in England's first innings, also showed that he can bat as well, giving good company to Brendan McCullum with an unbeaten 17 to his name with 3 fours, when all the players had to troop back to the pavilion because of rain coming in and ending the third day's play, with Brendan McCullum not out on 44, the captain of the New Zealand team, and Bruce Martin, the debutant, was not out on 17. 402 for 7 was what New Zealand had on the board. This was a lead of 235 runs and going to make life difficult for England. Let's look at the bowling figures. The bowling figures, James Anderson, pretty successful. 29 overs, 2 maidens, 108 runs and 4 wickets. The other successful bowler was Stuart Broad, 24 overs, 2 maidens, 89 runs and 2 wickets. The other successful bowler was Monty Panesar, 22 overs, 2 maidens, 1 for 83. Stephen Finn was wicketless, 26 overs, 3 maidens, 102 runs and no wicket. Jonathan Trott, 2 overs for 4 runs. And Joe Root, 5 overs, 1 maiden, none for 8. So that was the proceedings as far as the third day's play was concerned. In New Zealand, I'm sure they would like to swell this lead probably to 550 or 6 with Brendan McCullum still there, and really put the pressure right there on England on the fourth day. Well, so I'm moving out from here because of my YouTube broadcast having only 5 minutes more left. I'm moving on to the Sri Lanka versus Bangladesh Test Series. This was the first day of the first Test match, just played at the International Stadium. As far as Sri Lanka were concerned, they were the ones who actually won the toss. under the new full-time test captain Angelo Matthews, and they finished at 361 for 3. As I said, the feature was Kumar Sangakarra going on to make 142 with 16 fours and 3 sixes. But the good part of it, he was making his comeback after the injury, and that was a wonderful time for Kumar Sangakarra, who actually Karna Ratne was the one who actually opened with Dilshan, but Karna Ratne, after being hit again, came back and resumed his innings. He made 41 with 3 fours and 1 6. Dilshan was an attacking innings. In fact, 36 runs, the first 36 runs that Dilshan hit was all boundaries. So 9 fours were hit, and he finished, he was out for 54 of 63 balls and 9 fours. He was playing absolutely in one day mode, but Kumar Sangakarra was the one who also played pretty aggressively, because if you get a century in just two sessions, that is marvelous batting. And you know what Kumar Sangakarra is. I mean, he plays his cover drives to perfection. He drives well. And what was good yesterday was that he was liking the hook shot. There were a lot of hooks that he played, and he was a real treat to watch. 142 with 16 fours and 3 sixes. And after that, there was, as I said, every batsman from Sri Lanka contributed. Lairo Thiramane looked pretty impressive. He played some great square drives, and he had an unbeaten 74 to his name with 8 fours. And the captain Angelo Matthews was keeping company with an unbeaten 25 to his name with 4 fours. And Sri Lanka closing the day on the first day at Gaul in the first test match against Bangladesh at 361 for 3. The pitch was very easy to bat on. There were nothing really alarming about the pitch. The ball was coming nice and easy onto the bat. But probably Bangladesh could have put up a much better performance. It was very essential that you, on a good pitch, you have to stick to a very good line and length. Bowl a lot of good length deliveries. And also something that they could throw. But unfortunately, the Bangladesh bowlers leaked lots of runs, and that was the precise reason Sri Lanka finished with 361 for 3 at close of play on the first day of the first test between Bangladesh and Sri Lanka, played at the Gaul International Stadium. Bowling figures: Shahzad Hussain 13 overs 1 made and none for 60, tried a lot of bouncers. Abul Hassan 14.3 overs 1 made and none for 66, the most successful bowler, the right-arm off-spinner and an ever impressive bowler, Sohag Ghazi, was really flighting the ball. He actually was buying his wickets. In fact, Tilakuddin Dilshan was taken out of the crease by Sohag Ghazi. He was caught by Mominul Haq. Sangakarra also was really drawn by Sohag Ghazi, so he bowled well. 31 overs, 3 maiden, 3 for 101 for him. Ilyas Sani, the left-arm spinner, 14 overs, no maiden, none for 60, was not impressive at all. Mohammad Ashraful, 4 overs for 23, and Mahmudullah, 9 overs, 1 maiden, none for 34. But for Sri Lanka, for Bangladesh, the news was not good, because they didn't have Tamim Iqbal playing this match because of an injury, and hopefully he would be fit for the Colombo test match. So it was very sad to see that Bangladesh already don't have Shakib Al Hassan, who is not coming here. They also lost Tamim Iqbal. That was a big blow to them. And Ruben Hussain could also not play in this match. So Sri Lanka, they have finished off absolutely strongly as far as the first day is concerned on 361 for 3. Bangladesh on the morrow has to really pick up some quick wickets. It's not going to be easy. They still have some very good batting to come. Dinesh Chandimal is yet to come. They have Kulashekara, who is an all-rounder. Vittanage, who scored a century in the tour match, who was making his debut in this particular match for Sri Lanka. So he would be liking to go. And as far as Bangladesh were concerned, they had Anamul Haq and Mominul Haq actually making their test debut. So it's very essential for Sri Lanka to actually keep up the tempo. But for Bangladesh, they have to go and try to get the wickets as quickly as possible. Otherwise, it would be too late, and probably Sri Lanka might race off to a score of probably 600 runs. For Bangladesh, they have a lot of hard work to do. If they can do that, that would be something in their favor. Dear fans, friends and subscribers, I am also running out of my YouTube broadcast. I hope you all liked my cricket broadcast today on Cricket Happenings. Thanks for your company. Thanks for your continuous encouragement to this show. As I said, I love your encouragement. I love doing this show. And you guys are a great bunch of guys, dear friends and subscribers of Cricket Happenings. Thanks once again. This is your host, Ram, putting a wrap on this Cricket Happenings show for today. Thank you.